Hi, everyone. I'm Connie Chungjo, the CEO of Asian Americans Advancing Justice Los Angeles. And I'm so grateful to have with me today two individuals who I'll be interviewing. And we're doing these as part of Volunteer Appreciation Week, where we want to highlight members of the community who have been a longtime volunteer, and really to show the importance to having volunteer support here at Asian Americans Advancing Justice LA. So the first person I want to introduce is the Honorable Casimiro Tolentino, also known as Kaz, who has been on the board as a volunteer board member at Asian Americans Advancing Justice LA since our inception in 1983. Kaz, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks. You know, I was also not just a volunteer on the board, but I was also a volunteer, well, the word's not tutoring, but letting some of the law clerks who were volunteers and attorneys who were coming in as volunteers in the areas of labor law and employment discrimination law. So I was kind of their resource person for those areas, at least a good chunk of my early years.
I'd love to hear a little bit more about that and really what were the early years like when the board, I'm sure, had to do a lot of things and wear a lot of hats. And then I'd like to also introduce, of course, our founder and former executive director and now president emeritus, Stewart Kwoh. Stewart, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Connie. And it's great to be with you, Kaz.
Let's get started. I know you two are old friends and have been doing this work for many decades together. So I'd love to hear first from you, Kaz, how you got started with Asian Americans Advancing Justice LA and hooked up with Stewart for this.
Well, even before Advancing Justice, I knew Stewart from UCLA Law School. He was a mentor helped me get into law school, and while in law school, showed me the ropes. The other person there was Mike Ng. They were both third-year law students, and I was this incoming freshman law student. I think we all shared the same kind of values, and I think that's what drew us together. We were well aware of the Asian American history anyway. We were all active with the Asian American Studies Center. I knew that there were folks that were interested in pulling together an Asian law collective. And I knew Stewart was one of the main founders of that group. And I know that there were enough folks, I guess, with resources to be able to get that started. Due to my own financial stuff, I needed a job. So I joined the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare in the Civil Rights Division. I eventually came to California to see the Agricultural Labor Relations Board, and then eventually with the Department of Fair Employment and Housing, and then as an administrative law judge. During that time, when I came back to LA, because all my jobs are out of the Los Angeles area, I kept in touch with many of the APA attorneys. They were good friends from law school and good friends from the practice. We all knew that somehow we needed a voice, an advocacy voice. You saw NAACP speaking for the Black community, all deaf speaking for the Brown community, and there was no one really speaking for the Asian American group. One evening in the kitchen table, we met several APA folks, and we said, we're going to get one started. And I think, at least not at that kitchen table, but a little, maybe a couple more meetings, but Stewart committed to being a part-time director if we got him some money. The Methodist Church downtown was willing to lend us space, and they also part-time secretary. And the Asian American Presbyterian Church, the Methodist Church, all kind of worked their congregations and got us that seed money. And yes, we began in at the very basement of the Methodist Church. And eventually that church got torn down. And we ended up going to their building that they used then as the a facsimile of a church. It was a very old, leaky structure anyway. And I think maybe that's one thing that would kind of inspired us, because I think for some of us who remembers those days, I mean, the telephone didn't really work. There was no real intercom. The poor secretary had to run up a floor. We were several floors to tell him that a phone call was coming through. But we kind of persevered, and we slowly got programs together. We had very active support from the APA Bar Associations, and I think at one point I was head of the Philippine Lawyers Group. Stewart was head of the Southern California Chinese Lawyers, and Fred Fujioka was head of the Japanese American Bar Association. And they all had their kind of informal pro bono groups or pro bono programs, and that pretty much was incorporated into the legal center. Yeah, you'll hear me saying legal center periodically, because that's what I called it for about, 25, 30 years. But that was the beginnings. And I think one of the things that that struck me when we were trying to get everything started, Stewart would drag me to these various cocktail parties and meetings and talking and introducing them about the Asian Pacific American community. Many of them thought we were still the model minority, we didn't have any real problems, you know, that there were no real issues of concern, that we worked so hard, you know,
all the
and stereotypes of Asians, and that we were not a diverse community at all, culturally or linguistically.
Yeah,
you know, they saw us all with the same Asian faces, I suppose. But anyway, those were kind of the early years working through, and I credit Stewart for his fundraising skills. I mean, he probably went to three times more cocktail parties than I ever did. But he, you know, I don't remember, we had a, even before it became very popular, we had a Asian American culinary festival and at the Blue Whale. And oh my God, that took a lot of work. And you saw for the first, well, not for the first time, but many board members and their wives all working those food booths. I think that was a good experience, but I don't think we wanted to do it again.
In those early years, Stewart was a staff. And what was your role at then Asian Pacific American Legal Center?
I pretty much was a volunteer, a board member. I was the chair of the board. And as law clerks came in, I kind of let them know how things were and what we're expecting of them. And I was their resource person.
Yeah.
I remember I think when we were interviewing our first set of law clerks, you know, it's like, a lot of the questions were like, what exactly is this organization? and we had kind of had to, because we were recruiting them from law schools. And
yeah.
And I think we were getting a lot of UCLA folks who had really heard of us, but never really knew exactly what we were doing. So those were the kinds of things I was doing. And through all those years, I was pretty much a labor lawyer. The early years when I started with the legal center, I worked for the Writers Guild, then eventually the Department of Fair Employment and Housing. So that was my skill set that I tried to share with volunteer attorneys and volunteer folks. We also had direct services. And
yeah.
I think those were the first folks that we were hiring. We needed somebody, because that was the important aspect of the legal center for many of the APA churches and congregations, the lack of social services for a lot of unmet needs in the Chinatown community, and then the growing Koreatown community.
Yeah.
So that was an important part of our growth anyway.
Stewart, I'd love to hear from your vantage point, a little bit of the historical context. What made you want to start Asian Pacific American Legal Center in the beginning? And what was your vision?
Well, two things. One is that as I surveyed the field in Los Angeles, there was never any legal defense for the obviously the exclusion of Chinese and other Asians in the immigration laws. There was no defense from LA for the incarceration of Japanese Americans. So we were basically defenseless. And also in 1983, that was when President Reagan cut the legal services budget by one third. So what it meant was the legal aids could not provide or expand into the Asian American communities in a significant way. So we had both the civil rights needs and the direct service needs that were basically unmet. And LA County was the largest county with Asian American population growth surging. Way back in 1983, there was really a need to create a center. and the center would be a hybrid between civil rights and legal services. As Kaz said, that was the value that we talked about. And Kaz was a great partner in law school as well as after law school in pursuing that. Some of us in law school formed the Asian Law Collective, and that was a law office because we didn't want the strings attached with a 501c3 government authorized nonprofit. We basically had to charge very small fees to survive. Then I realized that we could get funding from foundations and corporations, even though there was a model minority myth. We could get some funding if we would persuade them that we were of need. And so then I suggested to the board that we shift from a community law office to the Asian Pacific American Legal Center. So I was the first part-time staff, ably aided by Kaz and a few other outstanding board members. People like Congresswoman Judy Chu was also on the board. And we had several ministers on the board. So I used my connections with the Protestant community to get a little funding from the Methodists, Presbyterians, Lutherans, you name it. I knew them growing up. So I approached them and they were willing to help out. So for the first 2 years, the only funding we got were from church groups and individual contributions. Wow. And then we started breaking into foundations, the State Bar Trust Fund, corporations. A board member named Lily Lee helped us a lot with the corporations. So we were able to grow fairly fast, but we always were in touch with the community. So when the community had a crisis, we tried to develop programs that would meet the needs. And we were able to raise money based on that too.
So you both mentioned the model minority myth. And I kind of joked like we're still seeing that problem today. So I'd like to hear from you how the issues that you're seeing today still relate to some of the issues you saw way back in the beginning when you first started the organization.
I think it's almost like cyclical. One of the main projects or programs we started was trying to deal with Vincent Chin. Vincent Chin was Chinese, but they thought he was Japanese. And Japanese corporations at that time, especially the automobile manufacturers, were making cheaper, smaller cars than Detroit. For some of those folks, they saw that it was the Japanese manufacturers that were taking away their jobs. Yeah, but that was, I think, a cover for the group that attacked Vincent Chin. I think it was more racism and anti-hate of Asians and using the cover of some economic situation. And I think that's what's happening today too, a lot of the anti-hate, because they don't see us in many ways as part and parcel in a fabric of this society. And then they look at the most vulnerable ones, and that's why the elderly are the ones that are being attacked. There's very little education about Asian Americans. I mean, that's usually the first thing, and they'll do it hesitantly. Well, you guys seem so well, you're so well educated, or you speak English so well. What kind of problems do you have? You know, for the first time, you tell them about literally our history here till you're blue in the face. You know, you tell them about the exclusion acts of the Japanese and Chinese, the massacres in the fields and the riots in the fields and trying to get a farm worker group together. To them, it's almost brand new that they see this from a very different perspective, because we've been so invisible in our own history. You know, at the Golden Rail photograph of when the Chinese workers built everything from San Francisco towards that Golden Rail, that photograph has no Chinese folks in it. And yet all the other Irishmen and other European workers are there. You look at a photograph of the signing of the UFW. I mean, you don't see an Asian face there. You see the brown faces. Mm-hmm. And it's not, I'm bringing them as examples, but as examples of, our lack of education about the history of Asians and also the history of many of the communities of color. And that's what's important about, I think, today, is that for the first time, we're looking more deeply into the different layers and nuance of our history. For the first time, people are seeing it as a reconstruction. So those kinds of things are cycling back into our history. And that history began literally when this nation was born.
I absolutely agree with you. It has been cyclical, what we're seeing. Stewart, do you have anything else that you would add? What are things that you were, you know, themes you're seeing or things that you're fighting for back then that we're still seeing today?
Well, the invisibility of Asian Americans continues in the schools, in government. Even though it's starting to change, we have a constant fight to become visible. So we don't have Asian American history as part of the history of California or the history of the country. It's just not taught. And even today, that remains true. That's why my wife and I developed 50 lesson plans over the last 10 years to present to the schools and the school districts. And they're starting to accept it because of the anti-Asian violence and the shock that that's had on the psyche. Even today, out of the 39 county departments in Los Angeles, there's no Asian head. There's no Asian head out of the 39 departments.
In a county that's 16% Asian.
Yeah, so what has changed? If you look at law firms, what percentage of the Asian American lawyers have made it to partner and beyond? It's still a very small percentage, even though a lot of Asian Americans are hired as beginning lawyers, that they're not promoted. I think the invisibility is still a major problem, but as Kaz said, we become the model minority because we value education, as do other people of color, but that is kind of used against us, saying, well, you can make it, you don't need any affirmative action. But then without that, we could see, well, what happened to the county departments? What happened to the law firms? What has happened in the other workplaces? So we basically get left behind. And sometimes if political leaders don't speak up, then we get left really far behind. Yeah. So I think that the big lesson for me is the model minority is there. We have to take actions to change it. So in our history, that has been what we have been known for. We've taken up cases like the El Monte case in 1995. We took up Vincent Chin's case. We took up Joseph Aleto's case. So we take up cases. We did a lot for the Korean American merchants during 1992's civil unrest and also bridged race relations as well. So unless we speak out and unless we take action, then we still remain invisible to the general population, even in a very diverse county like Los Angeles.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so Kaz, you have now been volunteering for Asian Americans Advancing Justice, or formerly Asian Pacific American Legal Center, for almost four decades. What is it about this organization that has kept you committed here for so long? Or could you share something that has been special for you here?
Well, one is Stewart Kwoh. I think under his leadership, we kept going forward and we were able to sustain quite a few things. But more importantly, it's the program. From Vincent Chin to Joseph Aleto, to the garment workers, to developing what we call then called the consortium, literally a national voice. It's tough to bring folks from the East Coast and the West Coast and to try and get them to buy in and weigh into a national voice. Also because there were a lot of good people coming in as attorneys, as volunteers, and as law clerks. I mean, I was inspired by the work that they were doing, given the resources that they had. So it's the leadership, the folks that were working, the staff, and the volunteers. They gave so much of their time and talent, keeping it and sustaining. And then, of course, the various programs that we were developing. They were kind of the very first steps of the Legal Center providing a voice, and with what Stewart's saying, trying to become more visible to the mainstream community.
Okay, so some of the people who watch this vlog are young adults who might have been born actually in the 2000s. So I think it would be interesting for them if you could paint a picture of what it was like to work at Asian Pacific American Legal Center in 1983 or the early 80s. You know, Kaz, you talked a little bit about the building of the church, but you know what else? What was it like to practice back then? You know, that was before cell phones. Did you guys use computers?
No, we had electric typewriters that were not IBMs. They were the old electric Remingtons or Olivetti. You had to cut and paste, or if you had a few minor spelling mistakes, that had to go through or white it out. So it was, I think, for some of who don't realize the practice of law in those days was very primitive. Even though those things were kind of primitive, that's what everyone else was doing, I suppose. You know, it would be nice to have an IBM Selectric so you could function a little faster and more efficiently. But I think people knew what they were getting into. I think there were some times of frustration, but at the same time, I think we all had the same goals and values about keeping the Legal Center's programs going.
Mm-hmm. I think we were very fortunate because we had a great group of staff members, a great group of board members, a great group of advisory board members, and a lot of pro bono lawyers who saw that we were struggling to keep up with the needs in the community and the events as they unfolded. So people banded together and really tried to help in whatever ways they could. I do remember we shared the first computers. There were like three or four people per computer. So that was life. And our bathrooms didn't always work. The elevators broke down. I remember our staff getting stuck in the elevators and crying. And yet that was our life. And I think people actually gave us more support because they saw that we were struggling. We really appreciate the whole community banding together to work together for the cause of the community. And that's been our hallmark from the start. And so we take a lot of pride in that common value that Kaz said earlier on.
So, Kaz and Stewart, why do you think it's important for people to volunteer at community organizations like Advancing Justice LA at a time like this?
Well, I think what's important is that they contribute a little bit, I suppose, to making this world a little better. I think with now the opening up of learning about your own history, the more you know about your education, I'll speak for myself. The fact that I learned about Asian American history in an undergrad and meeting folks that knew a lot more than I did and had lived, you know, made me want to help them out, I suppose, in a way, to move their programs forward. I got to know Philip Vera Cruz very well. I met Larry Leong in the last months of his life. And I think without them saying, well, I guess Philip said, essentially, you know, this fight needs to keep going and we need you guys to do it. And maybe that's the same thing I could say now. I won't speak for Stewart, but I think we've come to the point where we've given quite a lot of our talent as much as we can, but we need new voices, voices that'll keep and sustain us, I suppose.
Yes, I think that this is a time that we need a new wave, a new generation of activists, of service dedicated people to come forward. This is the time that they transform their lives and they transform the communities. I still remember what Lily Chin, Vincent's mom, said to me after she had fainted in trying to get a federal prosecution against the two killers of her son. She had fainted that afternoon at a crowded Chinatown restaurant. And I said, Lily, are you okay? And she said, "Stewart, there's nothing I can do to bring back Vincent, but I don't want any other mother to go through what I've gone through." And so we're seeing other mothers go through what she's gone through. And we have to stop that. We have to do everything we can to stop the scapegoating. We have to mobilize the community. We have to mobilize individuals. We have to mobilize people who could help, who are, you know, in higher places than perhaps we are. And we have to try our best to really galvanize the community at this moment. We may have differences, different opinions, but that really is secondary to the unity that we need to have at this very important juncture. Multiracial democracy is at stake. If Asians are seen as the other, if Blacks are seen as the other, murdered by police, if Latinos are seen as the other, where at the border, so many migrant children are in cages, if Native Americans are seen as the other, I don't know if America can exist as a multiracial democracy. Our population now is probably hovering over 35% of the US population. And if you exclude us, if you don't include us, I don't think our fragile democracy can continue being a strong democracy. I think it could actually fail. I don't think we're there yet. I think people do want to stand together and work together, including non-minorities. But I think it is a perilous time where we have to band together. And so I think that value that Kaz spoke about is more important than ever before, and that is the unity of a multiracial democracy actually functioning.
I think what's important is that we continue to build these bridges and reaching out to the other communities of color, and also to the, you know, to the white folks that are in the mainstream. We're a nation of immigrants. The successes of the folks that came here, they're all immigrants. We helped build the fabric of this society. And that's the only way we're going to survive is that we are going to have to be a multiracial, multi-immigrant society moving forward.
Kaz and Stewart, do you have any final message or words you want to share before I let you both go?
I think the work of the center needs to keep going. It needs to be sustained. I mean, this is the point in time in which we move forward in bigger steps than we had in the past. I think with technology, with the awakening of so many people about their own history and the building of bridges to like Black Lives Matter, and that we have issues that are also their issues. And it's important that we recognize those issues and we support their issues also. We need to make sure that, you know, we have some unifying values that'll keep us moving forward.
I think when you look at our history, every decade there's crises. I'm preparing a presentation where people don't know our history, where 19 Chinese were killed in Chinatown in 1871. The Chinese Exclusion Act, which eventually banned all Asians from coming to the United States between 1882 and 1943. And then you had the incarceration of 110,000 Japanese Americans. You had the killing of Vincent Chin in 1982, the killing of Joseph Aletto in 1999, the 500 or so South Asians who were shot or brutalized after 9/11/01. In those periods of time, or the civil unrest where 2,500 Korean American merchants lost their whole livelihoods. If you put yourselves into the shoes of those people at that time, the world was falling apart. The scapegoating has continued, even though for Asian Americans, it comes in episodes, it comes in waves. It doesn't come in a sustained way, like say for Black Americans. And so we have to remember that, because things will get better, but they don't really get better unless we change the structural racism that exists in our society. So our schools actually integrate Asian American history into regular history, into regular English. If we are treated as equals, we get promoted, we get hired. We are not treated as second class lawyers or second class citizens. So all of those things, we have to remember that the structures have to change. Otherwise, we'll see another wave in a few years, and then it'll shock our conscience. But we have to change the structures. Otherwise, we'll come back to the same place once again. So I'm encouraged because so many people have come out, so many people want to do something, but it's incumbent on Asian Americans Advancing Justice as one of the lead groups in the community to figure out how to incorporate all these young activists and older activists at this time when they have not come out before, but they're asking us, what do I do next? I've marched, I've demonstrated. My daughter-in-law spoke at a rally in Phoenix, and my six-year-old granddaughter went to the stage and said, I may be small, but I can make a big impact. How do we incorporate those people into our movement for change? That is the challenge that we'll always be faced with, but we have that challenge now. And I'm very happy that Connie Chung Joe has taken over the reins and is the new CEO. So Kaz and I can support her in her visions. But I think that this is the time we could come together and really change the communities for at least a few decades to come.
Well, thank you so much, Honorable Casimiro Tolentino and Mr. Stewart Kwoh, President Emeritus. I am so grateful and honored to be able to follow the legacy that you have established here at Asian Americans Advancing Justice LA and to follow in your footsteps. And thank you for taking a little time to share your some stories and your background with us.